I did have an embarrassing moment this morning, actually.
Oh, good.
You stop looking at me like that, eh? It wasn't anything important. It was just... Well, it was this.
It's a shopping bag.
It's a shopping female attire. Nightwear. It's a nightgown. Lounge.
You've gone mad.
Have I?
No other possible explanation.
I may not have good taste by your demanding standards, Peter, but I think you will agree that expensive taste is something I can manage, even without your expert help, that is.
Well, that just about sums it up, doesn't it? Your entire attitude to your chosen profession. It's all just an expensive joke at the expense of your customers.
Clients?
Clients, then. You just laugh them up your sleeve.
Oh, Christ, what do you expect me to do? Admire them? Deplore their bad taste in selecting my gallery for their expenditure? Or what exactly?
Oh,
you know that little Kandinsky?
The pastel drawing?
That's the one. Sold it yesterday.
Oh.
Well, don't look so disappointed.
Well, I get attached to them, you know. And we had only had it, what, a couple of months?
Something like that. Anyway, 35,000 quid.
It's obscene.
Don't be ridiculous. But anyway, I wanted to illustrate a simple little point. That's all. Now, your catalogue entry was particularly inspiring, you know.
Well, that's because I felt particularly strongly about the piece, isn't it? As you know full well, it's an important work, historic even. You can even sort of see a prefiguring of the whole abstract tradition in it. Amazing. It's...
Yes, all right. Stop drooling. It's gone.
Well, I'm sorry, that's all. I shall miss it.
Guess where it's going?
I don't know.
Guess?
Berlin? I don't know why I said that. How should I know?
Close. Kuwait.
Kuwait isn't close to Berlin.
You lack the artistic spirit, you see. You should try to develop a more creative attitude to life. Always nitpicking, always... Anyway, do you want to know exactly where it's going?
I don't know. Probably not.
I'm going to tell you anyway. Because I saw this transaction with mine own eyes.
To the artist that I can't help thinking of. I mean, how do you think Kandinsky would feel about it if he could hear you telling this story? Do you ever think about that?
Oh, don't be so naive. It's sickening. Pays your rent, doesn't it? Anyway. Do you want to hear the story or not?
Go on, then.
All right. So, one of these sort of vulpine husband-killing types, dripping with bad taste, you know, big gold bracelets stuck with diamonds, earrings that don't go with anything, Hermes scarf, Gucci shoes, nasty little beady eyes.
I know, exactly.
Yes, well, turns out she's from the National Bank of Kuwait. They've hired her. I mean,
what else?
Design consultant.
Lovely.
You'd like that.
This is going to be one of your depressing stories. I know it is. You only do it to annoy me, don't you?
Not at all. It's education. Anyway, Catherine, as I say, is a natural. Handled her with exemplary aplomb. Tried to get her interested in the catalogue, you know. Your deathless stuff, chiaroscuro.
No.
But she wasn't having it. Maybe she can't read. She waves the catalogue away, reaches into her handbag, and pulls out her swatches.
One of those?
Yes. Starts going around all the pictures, holding her swatches up against them to see if they're the right colour to match the taps on the jacuzzi. But sort of impatiently, you know, as if she's got better things to do than waste her time with Piero della Francesca.
We don't have anything by Piero della Francesca. And anyway, they don't have jacuzzis in banks.
Nitpick. You can't stop yourself, can you? Anyway. You're wrong for once, listen. She spots the Kandinsky, pauses, and yes, it is the right sort of brownie orange for her foul purposes. She calls Catherine over, asks her how much it is, and yes, 35,000 quid is just right for her budget too. If anything, she looks a bit disappointed it's not a bit more expensive.
Probably on a percentage.
Probably. But shall I tell you what the dear woman then asks my charming young assistant and confidant?
Confidant?
Jealousy is an ugly phenomenon, isn't it? No matter, I can live with it. Is it waterproof? She says.
What?
Yes. Is it waterproof? Catherine couldn't think of anything to say and just sort of stared at her in a charming but basically defeated manner. And the woman gives her a vicious look in return, as if she thinks she's dealing with some sort of idiot shop assistant.
You know, is it resistant to water?
She says. But Catherine sort of shook her head, and I must say, the old knuckles whitened a bit because I thought I saw the 35,000 quid walking out the door again. But she thought about it a bit, and I could see she was wavering, so I decided to step in myself.
How noble.
Quite. So, I slide out from my lair behind the Egyptian section, you know, and ask her if I can be of any assistance.
And Catherine gazes in admiration and gratitude at her benefactor and rescuer.
Nonsense. She's quite capable of looking after herself. Does karate, you know.
You just made that up.
No, I bloody didn't. Every Thursday and Saturday.
Christ, what for?
How should I know? Anyway, the ghastly woman gives me the once-over and decides to speak to me as if I'm a retard too. Will the colours run? She wants to know. Under the circumstances, I inquire tactfully, is she intending to put it up outside, perhaps? Of course not, she says. It's going in the shower.
I don't believe you.
Yes, you do. You can ask Catherine. The director's apartment in the National Bank of Kuwait has been designed and consulted by this appalling woman, and I promise you that she has gone off with the Vasily Kandinsky composition in hemicycles, pastels on board, 35,000 quid, will do nicely, thank you, clutched under her arm. Specifically, so she can go hang it on the wall of the shower for the director to admire while he's washing his hair. And it's quite a big shower, apparently. In case he wants to share the water with a confidant or two. Splash, splash, oops, bugger. There goes the Kandinsky, never mind. We can always get another one.
I knew I shouldn't have listened to this story.
Face the facts.
I am facing the facts.
What do you think? Something in the Times Literary Supplement, maybe?
Look, David, how many times do I have to tell you? Nobody takes that kind of thing seriously these days.
My clients do.
Well, that just demonstrates the bankruptcy of the whole bloody international art market, doesn't it?
Suit yourself. Although bankruptcy is not exactly the word I choose to describe it. So where do you think a terse little critical masterpiece should appear?
I'm thinking of a piece for the TRA, if you must know.
Oh, yes. Good idea.
Never heard of it.
Oh, really, David. Tennessee Review of Architecture. You want to try and keep up, you know.
Don't tell me it's big in New York.
Huge. Very telling.
Oh, good. And I suppose I'll just be revealing my ignorance still further if I ask why on earth an architectural review should. Oh, she's pursing her lips at me, Peter.
TRA hasn't focused on architecture for years, David.
Well, that's why everybody has to read it. It was one of the first journals to embrace post-conceptual reparametrization. You see?
I see. Well, that sounds splendid. And you think we can liven up the dull pages of the TRA with some spurious Soviet art, eh?
Look, David, this is not a good attitude. We're dealing with the birth of an artistic movement here. This is history in the making.
What on earth are you talking about? This is why I don't usually do contemporary, you know? All this bloody double thing. I mean, look at it. It's not even painted on a proper canvas.
But that's the whole point. That's the whole reason why Bolotnikov is so important. Don't you understand anything? Bolotnikov could never afford real canvas, you see. But he worked in a factory, so he used to bring home old cardboard boxes to paint on.
Great.
But that's not all. The best part is, if you look at the backs of the paintings, you can see where the cardboard boxes came from.
It It's a subtext.
That's right.
What does it say?
It says V.I. Lennon Machine Tools Collective.
No. That's wonderful. So his work is simultaneously an archaeology of Soviet industrialization. Machine tools. Fantastic, darling. What are his other pieces based on?
Based on?
What are you talking about?
Oh, there are some shoe boxes. One from a rope factory. I don't remember. This is the best one, though. That's why we're committed to this one. It's the central masterpiece of the whole Soviet dissident school. There'll be books written about this in a few years. Sergei's already registered a preliminary list of Bolotnikov's works with an insurance company in Moscow, just to be on the safe side. It's going to look wonderful in the catalogues. Imagine, Bolotnikov, study number 4, crayon on compressed paper. V.I. Lennon Machine Tools Collective, stencil on reverse.
But if it's on the back, no one will be able to read it, will they? I mean, if it's on the back, I mean, well, they won't be able to. Good Lord. Oh, is that the time?
Or should I trot along to La Louche and get you one of these? Just hypothetically supposing I could afford it, I think.
You could do worse. It is beautiful, isn't it?
I think it depends on who's inside. Empty like this, it doesn't really do anything for me. It seems a bit pointless.
Was she like the kickboxer?
Katie. It's karate. Oh, she's 24. She's sort of enthusiastic and healthy and a bit naive.
But physically?
Oh, I don't know.
Well, make an effort.
Well, she's ordinary, like you.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Oh, God. I told you.
Oh, yes, I see what you mean now.
I only meant physically.
Oh, yes, insult to injury. Pour it on.
No, I only meant, well, you're about the same size and everything.
Oh, God, shall I?
Well, I suppose you could.
Just as an experiment?
Absolutely.
Right then. How shall I be? Frumpy? Shy? Ordinary?
I don't know. Seductive?
Oh, you idiot. All right. And then you're taking me out to dinner, aren't you? Okay? Won't be a minute.
She goes into the bedroom to change. Peter picks up the book of Ursula's poetry. The key turns in the lock.
What are you doing here? Never mind, I don't want to know. Peter, you're reading one of my books. Very well, I forgive you, whatever you've done. Good taste is enough to excuse most things, isn't it? No, don't answer. Don't say anything. If you say anything, if you start talking and articulating your thoughts, then sooner or later you will feel compelled to utter some hypocritical half-truth in order to avert the humiliation of my husband at my hands. But I would not like such an occurrence to come between us. You are, after all, a person of some sensitivity. So, Peter, dear, don't bother. His fate is sealed. Put the book down. You can finish it later. There's a good boy. Now, listen to me very carefully, and I will give you your instructions. When I clap my hands, I want you to get up, go downstairs, go to the front of the building, and go to the taxi that is waiting there. Then you will pay for the taxi. It will be very expensive, Peter, because I have been riding round and round in it, preparing my revenge and sharpening, darling, my claws. But I want you to pay for it as a punishment. I don't know exactly what you've done, but Peter, I know that you have done something. Whatever it is, I lament for you. And then we'll be quits. It will be quite all right between us after that. I feel that somehow. Inside the taxi, there is a large box.
It is quite heavy. Think of it as a symbol of your misdeeds. Drag it, darling, up the stairs. Bring it here to me, deposit it at my feet, and then we'll talk further. And don't look so frightened, it's most unappealing. No, don't talk. Go.
She takes up the book and sits in the same place.
Da 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 da.
Reconnected the answering machine.
Oh.
Well, sorry, I disconnected. You see, when I have some time off, it's the only way I can get away from the clients.
You've got a message?
Yes.
Well, don't you think you'd better listen to it?
Yes. Only...
What?
Well, it might be from my wife.
So what?
Right.
Hello, David.
Mrs. Witcherly and I are having a lovely time out here in Devon with the donkey. I just thought I should call in to let you know that I'm thinking of you. See you soon.
Was that her?
Wait, there's another one.
Hello, David Davidovich. Here is Sergei in sunny Moscow. I have great news. Today I'm talking to man of Guggenheim Foundation, Moscow. I am explaining to him all about the importance of Bolotnikov for glorious Soviet art history. He says Guggenheim Foundation must have machine tools painting. Money no object, he says. I say, okay, will cost $250,000. He says, okay. He's visiting London tomorrow with security assistant Mr. Boris Borisovich. Please to give him painting. He signed the receipt. Guggenheim Foundation Moscow give us money. I take my 10%. Business is business, baby. Dos Fidelia.
What's that about?
Well, it's something I've been working on with Peter and Daisy. Didn't expect it to move so fast, I must say.
You just have the best way of making money out of anyone I've ever met.
Well, actually, I'm a bit nervous about the Russian thing. This whole Bolotnik idea feels like a joke that's getting out of hand.
Why do you say that?
The thing is... Well, this business I resides on is some basic level of artistic merit, sustaining some minimal aesthetic standards, you know.
That's not what you said about that Joseph Boy's show.
No, well, maybe I just don't like doing contemporary. Renaissance, modern, anything, just not contemporary.
Well, that's ridiculous.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is. Everything in the gallery is contemporary. I mean, this is right now, so it's contemporary. Even if it was done hundreds of years ago or something.
Well, that's the most ridiculous argument I've ever heard. I mean, if you accepted that, then it would all just be equivalent, wouldn't it? Giotto, Manet, Velasquez.
Andy Warhol, Robert Motherwell, Henry Moore. It's all equivalent. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Don't you see?
No, of course not.
Well, you should. Taste isn't just static. If you look at your Giotto or... Velasquez, or whatever it is, you're looking at it from the perspective of now, aren't you?
No, I'm not.
Well, yes, you are.
No, I'm not. I mean, I can see what you're trying to say in a general sort of way, but you see, as far as I'm concerned, it's just not true. When I look at a painting, you see, I...
Or music, it's the same with music.
Yeah, yes, I know. Music, books, anything, the principle is the same, but what you're suggesting is that a person looks at everything from the same point of view and judges it according to whether he likes it or not, right?
Right.
Wrong. As far as I'm concerned, anyway, because you're forgetting the most important thing.
I know what you're going to say. Price.
Price? Well, that does come into it, but no, that's not what I was going to say, actually. I was thinking about something else entirely. Do you want a drink?
Thanks. Just a Coke, or an energy drink if you have one.
Perrier?
Okay. What?
prejudice.
You're motivated by prejudice?
Prejudice.
Then that's terrible.
No, it isn't. That's what education's for.
Well, that's the most ridiculous argument I've ever heard.
Education is the process of instilling the right prejudices in people who otherwise wouldn't be able to tell the difference. That's the whole point of it. Look, if I look at a Renoir, say, well, I see a naked girl, nice brushwork, nice rendition of light, all that, just like anyone else. But you see, fortunately, I still have my prejudices to guide me, don't I? So I look at it, and what I see above all is a Renoir. That's the most important thing about it, as far as I'm concerned. Actually, and my prejudices, fortunately, have equipped me with a finely balanced response to the whole concept of Renoir. And that makes my opinion and judgment about the painting so much more, well, so much better than anyone else's. In every way, than the opinion or judgment of someone without these advantages. It stands to reason. Now, if you take someone who hasn't had these prejudices beaten into
like
them,
me, you mean?
Oh, no, you're not immune, that's right. Even you, I mean, you went to university, didn't you?
Well, only Birmingham.
Oh, no, they had one. Sorry.
Fine.
Absolutely. But prejudice is my guide, you see. What did you read at the university? What did you study? What did you do?
Engineering.
Really?
Really? It was all in my CV, in some detail, actually. Did you read it? I thought that's why I got the job. Why did you give me the job if you didn't even read my CV?
Oh, yes, I'm sure I read it at the time. But, well, you know, things sort of blur together after a while. Did you specialise in anything particular? I can't remember.
What do you mean, like Venetian glass or Flemish cathedral painting or something? Post-discursivism? Well, actually, I did. Elastics research.
Elastics research?
That's right. I'm an elasticist.
I had no idea that that discipline ever existed.
Well, that just shows the limits of your famous prejudices, doesn't it? Not to mention your idea of education. Because not only that are there whole fields of knowledge which are closed to you from the start, but how can you ever deal with anything new?
There is nothing new. Everybody knows that.
Rubbish.
But anyway, I have a blanket prejudice against anything that might be. So there, and you noticed.
Well, now you come to mention it. I mean, I suppose I'm not surprised to hear it. But anyway, for your information, there is an International Association of Elastics. There's Institute of Elastics. There's an annual conference. There are several journals. All that sort of thing. It's very important for industrial design.
Oh, yes, I met an industrial designer once.
So you know it exists, then? Congratulations. Did you talk about Giotto?
Possibly. Mm. Anyway, why did you give it all up if it's so fascinating?
Well, you know, it's Britain, so it's all completely underfunded. You have to go to Germany.
Oh, why Germany?
Because Germany leads the world in elastics research, that's why.
And this is all happening in Birmingham, is it?
Partly.
Yes, how did I guess that? Anyway, the whole thing sounds absolutely ghastly.
The whole thing sounds absolutely ghastly. I mean, how many times have you said that in your whole life? Do you think it answers anything? You can't just answer science with prejudice. Just write it off.
Why not?
Because, well, if you didn't have science, then you wouldn't be able to produce anything, would you?
Well, the only thing that is worth producing is art, culture, civilization.
But you laugh yourself stupid if anyone takes any interest in art or culture or civilization.
But that's just a pose. You have to have something that you care about in life, don't you?
What do you mean?
Well, Catherine, you know, I'm really a very sincere person. Sometimes, anyway.
Are you?
Yes. Only, well, I suppose I'm afraid of showing it sometimes.
But why?
Well, it's because... You won't laugh, will you?
Oh, no.
Promise?
Promise.
Thank you. It's because I'm really very shy, you see.
Hello?
Oh, Sergei, yes! Yes! Yeah, really? Yes. Look, I understand. I got your message. Don't worry. Hmm? What's the matter? Is everything all right? Yeah. Good. Yes, yes, yes. What's his name, the man from the Guggenheim Foundation? Hmm? Adams? How do you spell it? Okay. Yes. And he insists on the machine tool's picture, yes? Does he? Yes, okay. What? No, she's away for the weekend. Visiting a donkey sanctuary. Donkey! Never mind, I said, never mind, it doesn't matter. Yes, I will. That's right. Yes, all alone. Yes, yes. Well, look, tell Mr. Adams, we have a lot of interest in the Bolotnikov. You know, sort of suggest that maybe $250,000 isn't enough. Good. Splendid. Oh, look, my wife's just arrived. Hello, Ursula.
Hello, David. What a nice surprise.
Sergei says hello.
Tell Sergei I think he's a slimy little creeper. I hope he gets shot.
Yes. Yes, Ursula says hello too. Listen, Sergei, I think that all sounds just about okay. We'll deal with Mr. Adams and Mr. Borozovich when they get here then, yes? Yes. Okay. Yeah, I'll talk to Peter about it, thanks. Bye. Bye. Oh, God, the lasagna.